All right. Well, good morning, guys. It's such a pleasure to be here with you guys this morning. We had an amazing 9 o'clock service, and I know God has. It's just going to get more and more intense. And so, who's hungry for a touch of the Lord tonight? This morning, we had an awesome worship service. Can I just ask you guys just stand up real quick? I just want to. The Holy Spirit's here, and we just want to get in into the Word, but. Just close your eyes wherever you are. Holy Spirit, we thank you for your presence. We acknowledge your presence in this place. We ask that you would intensify your touch. Just breathe them in. Holy Spirit, we love you. We need you. Just say with me, Holy Spirit, we give you total freedom. Have your way this morning. Speak to me. Confront me. Comfort me, embrace me. I need a fresh touch in Jesus' name. Amen. Give Jesus a big hand wherever you are. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. You may be seated. I was sharing this first service at the 9 o'clock about how crazy it is. And I don't know if you noticed this, but today is 11-11. Who noticed this 11-11? All right, well, you may think, well, I mean, okay, what does that mean? Maybe 3-4 years ago, I was going through this season of my life that I was seeing 11 all over the place. It was either 11-11 or 1-11. It was kind of freaking me out. Has anybody had these experiences where you see signs or prophetic, you know, signs? And I had no clue it was a prophetic sign. I thought it was kind of weird because... And I'm not going to go into the whole story, but we were actually in the process of acquiring a farm property. And I had just come out of a meeting and where one of the potential donors had just said no. And that morning, I had seen 11-11. And when I was in traffic driving back home in our hometown, São Paulo, Brazil, I was driving and stuck in traffic, which is quite common to do in Brazil or in São Paulo. I looked in front of me, and the license plate was 11-11. And I thought, this is freaky. And then I looked up, and in the building, there was a building whose number was 11-11. And I'm like, God, what are you trying to say? And I had no clue what he was trying to tell me. But maybe 3 weeks later, I found myself exactly in this room. And I was actually right beneath that exit sign. And I was talking to Sean Boltz, and I said, Sean, you're probably the first one I'm going to ask you this because it's kind of weird, but I haven't actually had courage to talk to many people about this, but I'm going through maybe now it's 4 months, I've been seeing 11-11 all over the place. And he told me exactly what it meant. He actually brought a lot of clarity. And after that, we started seeing a bunch of stuff happening, and every time that I would see breakthrough, there was 11 there. And I thought that it was crazy that today on 11-11, I would be in the same room, and just this year alone, we've traveled on maybe 12 or 13 nations preaching the gospel. And right this Sunday, 11-11, I would be in the same room where I believe Sean was used of the Lord to give me a key to unlock this thing. And as I was walking out between the two services, I went to the restroom, I was walking out, a sister here just pulled me aside and she said, she was asking me about this 11-11, if I heard about somebody that was teaching about it. And she pointed this thing out of Deuteronomy 11-11. And I want to actually just read this out to you, Deuteronomy 11-11. If you can just open up real quick, this is not part of my message, but I felt this is prophetic. And it says this, and you know, today there were certain things that are making more sense. Actually, somebody else came in next to me here and said, you're going to get revelation even as you speak. And it's like some pieces are falling into place. And this is what I found out. Deuteronomy 11:11 says, but the land which you cross over to possess is a land of hills and valleys which drinks water from the rain of heaven. You know, I feel like the Lord is actually talking to us about properties. And I just feel like it has nothing to do with my message today, but I feel it's very strategic that we would pray for properties. So this is what I want to do before I get into the word this morning. I want to pray for you if you're believing the Lord for your own property, either a house or for a property for your business or even for church. Just stand up. I want to pray for you today. I feel there's something strategic about this. And this is not numerology or anything, but I believe it's totally prophetic. And I believe the Lord's going to release something. So just go like that. Open up your spirit. Father, we just want to come into alignment to what the Spirit is speaking to the bride right now. And right now, Father God, we're believing for this anointing of 11:11. Just as you spoke to the people of Israel, as you would cross over, you would possess land. Father God, I stand with my brothers and my sisters this morning, and I ask that you would deliver land to us. Would you, Father God, give us property? I feel so strategic. The Lord is actually, you know, there's something about when you own the title to that property that you have spiritual authority to actually establish the kingdom in that place. So some of you that have just moved out here to SoCal and you're just renting because it's transition, I believe the Lord is telling you right now, just dream for property. Title in your name, because you will have authority to speak kingdom activity in that region. So right now, Father God, I pray for the release of finances. I pray, Father God, for the favor of men. I pray for the favor in negotiations right now. Father God, anything that has been blocking the deals to go through, would you lift it off in Jesus' name? In Jesus' name. And all God's people said amen. 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 Praise God. Praise God. We've been, like, last 3-4 years, we've been going through a season of just acquiring properties. And I've never been one of those, you know, this property, you know, like, oh, I want land. But I just felt the Lord say, you have to go for land. There's something about the kingdom message, you know, and this is not even part of my message, but if you just take these notes real quick. You know, any kingdom needs at least 5 things. You know, a kingdom needs a king. All right, so say with me, King Jesus. King Jesus. So that's our king, all right? So a kingdom needs a king. A kingdom also needs a people. And just say with me, church. Church. That's us. We are his people, the ecclesia, the chosen ones, the called out. So a kingdom needs a king. A kingdom needs a people. A kingdom needs a constitution. And that's the word of God. That's the Bible. A constitution which would be a code of ethics, something that you follow. Now, a kingdom also needs different stratas of influence, and those are keys of the kingdom. Does that make sense? That's why there are certain people that you ask for prayer and certain people that you don't ask for prayer. Now, Jesus loves everybody, but there are certain people that I know when I'm going through certain things, I know who to call. I'm like, brother, you need to lay hands on me right now. Break this thing off. Why? Because I recognize kingdom authority in that brother that I may not recognize in somebody else. It does not mean that they're not child of God. Everybody's a child. If you know, he's a child of God as well. He's loved by the Lord. But there's a kingdom, a dimension of authority, and there's differences. There's different stratus. Does that make sense? And so my prayer is that I always continue to grow in kingdom authority, in kingdom anointing. Does that make sense? So a kingdom needs a king. It needs people. It needs a constitution, the word. A kingdom has different levels of authority and influence and impact and anointing. And a kingdom needs territory. What validates the crown is a territory. You know, and I believe that the Lord, when he places us in the garden in Genesis 1, he's actually given us territory. He's saying, now you will tend this land and you will multiply. Does that make sense? The Lord brought you to LA, if either you were born here or the Lord brought you over here, because he's given you this place as territory. And he's saying, this is where you'll actually live out your kingdom influence, and you will live out and see the kingdom constitution create and bear fruit. And this is where you, the kingdom people, will worship the King of Kings, and you need a territory for that. Does that make sense? So yes, it is a spiritual kingdom, but it has a manifestation in the physical. That's why it is totally kingdom for you to acquire land. And I think it's kind of crazy because I learned that watching a mafia movie. Because the Godfather in the mafia movie says, hey, God does not make land anymore. And I'm thinking, wow, that's true. That's why till today there are wars over property. I just got back from Israel. That's what's happening. It's over property. You know, because that means something in the spiritual realm as well. So anyways, Matthew 4, going into the Word. Matthew 4 is something that I've been actually struggling with a while, and I want to share from the depth of my heart today as a Brazilian. I know there might be Brazilians in this place. Are there any Brazilians here? Are you? All right. Okay. All right. So for us, now let me ask you, any Latin Americans, South Americans, Latin Americans in this place? Okay. I want to talk to you about something that's been happening in our continent. We've been experiencing a move of God. I come from a country of 200 million people. 200 million people. It's not as big as America, but it's quite large. 200 million people. Out of the 200 million people, 60 million profess faith in Jesus Christ. Evangelicals, born-again believers. 60 million out of 200 million. Now, initially, we would say, wow, that's amazing. We'll celebrate that. But if you live in the country where I live, you celebrate it, but you also are not too sure if you want to celebrate that. Because the thing is, and this is it started in me when I became a dad, and this is 3 years ago. My wife is right here. We have two boys, Zach and Koa. Zach is three, Koa is one. But I started thinking about the country where they'll grow up. And basically, 10 years ago, I chose to move back from America to Brazil to go into ministry. I was doing ministry here in North Carolina, and I was basically, just on the way to living the American dream. And I felt the Lord in one of my prayer times confront me with the question, are you in this for the kingdom dream or the American dream? Wow. And I said, kingdom dream, Lord. And he asked me again. I said, oh, kingdom dream. Third time he asked me, I said, kingdom dream. And then he says, well, if it's the kingdom dream, give up your green card and move back to Brazil. Tell them you're not going to become a citizen. Tell them you're not going to take over the church. Tell them you're not going to be one of the pastors that's going to take, with the American salary. You're going to move back to Brazil. And I want you to go into the universities and see the kingdom established inside the universities. That was 10 years ago. And so I moved back, and I was glad that I did, because when I was back in Brazil, that's when I met my wife. And we've been actually partnering with the Holy Spirit to see Dunamis, which is the name of the movement that we lead, take over universities. We're in 240 university campuses right now. They meet weekly and cry out for revival inside the university campuses. And we've been seeing amazing things happen. And maybe 6 years ago, June and I, we took over our local church as senior leaders, and we've been seeing the Lord do things, astounding things inside the church and also in the city and in the nation, in the nations. But one of the things is, when I became a dad, I started thinking, my son is going to grow up in a pretty much evangelical country. And the statistics says that in 2028, Brazil will be over 50% evangelical. But the question is, why is it that we have so many evangelicals in Brazil and we have the worst case of corruption in the history of modern history? So I've been asking these things. Why is it that we have so many evangelicals in Brazil and we're probably the number one human trafficking country? Why is it that we have so many evangelicals in our nation, mega churches? In my city alone, the March for Jesus, we put 2 million evangelicals on the streets. But why is it that in my city, there's so much crime rate? In Brazil alone, last year, 65,000 people were murdered. I'm asking, why is it that in the history of our new democracy, we're going right now through the worst economical crisis? But we'll say, oh, but our churches are humongous. Our church planting movements are gigantic. And I'm seeing a young generation growing up saying, and it's a matter of time that they'll ask us, hey, you guys preach Jesus, and Jesus is supposed to be the truth that transforms the world, but how come that in our country, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da? And so I'm wrestling with these issues, and I once heard of a very wise man. He's actually a, He was a missionary for a long time, and he's a professor here at Fuller. And we were talking one time, and he said, you know, a true revival goes through three stages. A true revival goes through three stages. And I started understanding it. He says, the first stage of a true revival is the awakening of the saints. So that's the church. It's us. You know, it always starts in the house. You know, and so it's when we come back to our first love. And how many of you just love the presence of the Lord? Amen. You know, I just saw Jen just talk about the encounter night. You know, when you live what you guys live, encounter nights, that's revival. It's like, man, every day I just want to be in the presence. When you lose track of time, you don't care what's going on Netflix, you don't care what's going on in your social medias or what your friends are doing. It's like, I just want to be here in the presence. That's the first sign of a true revival. It's like that we're coming back to our first love. Now, that's a sign of true revival, but it doesn't stop there. It actually can't stop there, because once you start experiencing the presence, the next question is, all right, I'm having the time of my life in the presence, but my cousin has no clue that this is possible. My coworker has no clue that this is available. My colleague, I mean, she needs to know that she can actually have that, which will spark then into a harvest of the lost. Does that make sense? That's the second part of a true revival. So it's awakening of the saints, then the harvest of the lost, which, you know, ramifications of that could be evangelism, missions, church planting, and so forth. So that's amazing. And I'd say most of Latin America, and I've been speaking in places like Colombia and Guatemala and Argentina, places where they've experienced true revivals in the past. And I would say Brazil is in the midst of a move of God right now as we speak. But we are yet to see in Latin America, and I would say there are a few places in the world in church history where we've seen, and it has happened, where we come to the third stage of a true revival, which is not only awakening of the saints, not only a harvest of the lost, but it becomes social transformation. And once all the kingdoms of this world become the kingdom of our God. You know, and when you look at what Jesus came to do here, he was actually speaking about a kingdom coming and being established like it was in Genesis, coming back in, and until the kingdoms of this world, and you're probably familiar with the phrase seven mountains or with the term seven mountains, and until we see the kingdom of God in education, until we see the kingdom of God in business, until we see the kingdom of God in arts, entertainment, and all the spheres of society. Does that make sense? So a true revival will spark inside the church, will reach the lost, but eventually will go into the streets and transform society until the kingdoms of this world become the kingdom of our God. And if we look at what Jesus did, he was always speaking about that. Look at me, look with me, Matthew 4:17. It says, from that time on, Jesus began to preach and to say, repent. Say with me, repent. It's the word metanoia, which means in Greek, you know, the renewal of your mind. It says, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Say with me, kingdom of heaven. Kingdom of heaven. See, Jesus was always talking about kingdom of heaven. Now, look at verse 23, same chapter, verse 23 says, and Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues. And there's a pattern here. You got to pay attention to this pattern. So he's teaching in their synagogues. He's preaching the gospel of the? Now, check this out. He did not come to preach the gospel of salvation. Jesus did not come. He did not come here to preach the gospel of social justice. He did not come here to preach the gospel of grace. I mean, social justice is in the kingdom. Grace is in the kingdom. Salvation is part of the kingdom. But what he came to do was preach the gospel of the kingdom. And so he taught in the synagogue. He preached the gospel of the kingdom and healing all kinds of sickness and all kinds of disease among the people. Matthew 9, five chapters ahead. Just turn with me, verse 35. Matthew 9:35 says, then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues. Once again, the same pattern, preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. So if If you're taking notes, Jesus' public ministry, you could sum it up into four things. Four things that Jesus' public ministry pretty much entailed. And the first thing that he did was he preached the kingdom. So Jesus preached the kingdom, Jesus taught the kingdom, Jesus healed the sick, and Jesus delivered the oppressed. Four things. You'll see this all across the four Gospels. You read it one after another. You'll see he's preaching the kingdom, he's teaching the kingdom, he's healing the sick, and he's delivering or bringing deliverance to the oppressed or the demon-possessed. And that's crazy because a lot of times I thought teaching and preaching, same thing. What's the difference when somebody preaches the kingdom and teaches the kingdom? It's quite simple, actually. When I went into studying this, when you teach the kingdom, you're actually explaining the kingdom. Now, how many of you remember when he would actually use a parable that says, the kingdom of God is like a seed of mustard? Remember that? He was actually teaching, he was explaining. This is how the kingdom of God functions. The kingdom of God is like leaven in a dough of bread. He's explaining. Now, when he comes into the synagogues and he starts preaching the kingdom, and you need to understand that in the kingdom, nothing exists prior to having a declaration to it. So everything that exists today was once declared in the spirit. This that we see, that we touch, is only a manifestation of something that happened first in the spirit. Does that make sense? How did God create this world as we know it? He says, let there be light, and there was. He did not create it with his hands. He created with his words. So everything he's spoken into existence. So Jesus, as he's walking here, he's doing just like he saw how it was done in Genesis. He's speaking it out. And once he speaks it, when he preaches it, a prophetic declaration in the spirit, all he has to do is call the sick. It's going to manifest in the physical. Be healed. Pick up your mat and walk. Just open up your eyes. You'll see. And as he did it, he was manifesting the kingdom. And for people that had a difficulty in understanding or discerning what he was doing, he says, the kingdom of God is at hand. He would cast out a demon and say, this is the kingdom. He would heal the sick and say, this is the kingdom. Does that make sense? I remember when I moved back to Brazil 10 years ago, like I was telling you, and I got a phone call maybe 2 months after I was home, and somebody asked me, hey, Randy Clark is coming, and he was been going, you guys know who Randy Clark is? And he's a healing evangelist, and he said, we need a translator. Do you want to come and translate for Randy? I'm like, for sure. And so I traveled a bit and with Randy and translated for him, and one of the things that would happen was at the end of the meetings, there would be such a huge line of sick people waiting for prayer that Randy would sometimes look at the line and says, T, if we don't split this thing up, we're never going to get back to the hotel. He says, now you get half and I get half. And I'm like, Randy, I'm just a translator. And I remember the first time I did that, I said, what do I do? I'm just a translator. He says, just do exactly like I'm doing you. You do it. And so I've been translating, so I knew exactly what he was saying. So I just imitated him. And I started seeing miracle after miracle after miracle. I mean, the deaf hearing, the blind seeing. I mean, it was one after another. And you feel like you're anointed. And you don't realize you're actually riding his wave. Until 4 months later, I tried to do it on my own and nothing happened. I went back to the hotel room. I cried. The Lord said, now, do you want to go and build your own anointing? Go pray, go fast, and go pay the price for it. That's another message, but let's go back to this one here. But I remember as I was praying for the sick, we came to this person that was elderly, and she was healed of cancer. I mean, you could see it. I mean, the tumor disappeared. I mean, right there in front of you, it was right there, instantaneous. I came back to the bus, and we were going to go back to the hotel, and Randy looked at me, and he said, how was your night praying for the sick? I said, it was amazing. And I remember that he kind of picked up that I wasn't okay, and he kept asking. And suddenly I said, you know, Randy, I got to ask you something, and I don't mean to be offensive, and I don't mean to be cynical. I don't mean to be skeptical, but I got to ask you. I said, what's the use of healing somebody if they're going to die anyway? I said, that person is elderly. I mean, maybe we helped her get maybe 10 extra years of life, but one day she's going to die. And I felt so bad for asking that, but I know a lot of you have asked that question inside your head, so I'm just getting it out for you. And he said, no, that's okay. And he asked me, have you seen any formerly blind person that Jesus healed walking around? I'm like, nope. Have you seen a former lame man that Jesus healed walking around? I'm like, nope. And he says, everybody that Jesus healed died. I said, so he says, you got to look at the supernatural beyond the event. So he says, when you heal somebody, yes, there is the event. That's for sure. There is relief coming, physical relief to that pain that is immediate and felt need. That's one. Number two, if that doesn't happen, anyways, not everybody's going to be healed, but everybody's going to be loved. So if you pray with love, that person will sense love, and love is eternal. Don't look at somebody, just another one to pray for healing so I can actually have a good story to tell people. No. Do you love that person? Does that make sense? So, and then he says, number three, when Jesus came on earth and inaugurated the kingdom, as you pray for the sick, as you cast out demons, it's kind of like that picture of man on the moon, and he spikes the flag of the country he represents. He says, we made it here. Does that make sense? He says, that's what you're doing in the spirit. You're taking territory and saying, not here, Satan. You used to have authority here, but not here anymore. Does that make sense? And number four, he says, it's an invitation to an open portal. Remember, Jesus says, I only do what I see the Father tell me to do. I only say what the Father tells me to say. What is he saying? He says, I live the supernatural naturally. That's my lifestyle. Everywhere I go, I'm under that portal. And so when you see healings or supernatural events, they're actually an invitation to a supernatural lifestyle. And so when I started understanding that, you know, it totally changed my mind and changed the way that I saw the supernatural. And it's crazy because Jesus was actually just doing what the Father told him to do. So he's just saying, I speak the kingdom, and he speaks the kingdom. Now just manifest the kingdom. He manifests the kingdom. It's totally automatic. Does that make sense? It's just part of who he is. It's just flowing out of the essence of who he is. And Jesus was kingdom incarnate. So Jesus comes in and he initiates the kingdom incarnate. He picks up from Genesis 3, the fall of man. And when he picks up from Genesis 3, the fall of man, he's not talking about salvation only, or grace, or salvation by grace, or justification, or he's actually speaking about something greater. He's speaking about the kingdom. See, I'll tell you, this is a parenthesis. One of the bad things, or one of the things that I feel that the Lord is going to shift in the next few years in the Western church is, and hear my heart on this, is a lot of what we live as Western Christianity is based off Pauline letters and doctrines to the church and not necessarily a Jesus pattern of living out the kingdom. So we look at Paul, and what does Paul say? And I love Paul. And everything he says that's in the Bible was inspired by the Holy Spirit and is the Word of God. But are we looking at and seeing how did Jesus live out the kingdom? Does that make sense? Because Jesus comes in and he's preaching about this gospel of the kingdom. Now, what is the gospel of the kingdom? I want you to open with me Mark chapter 1, verse 14. And I'm burning with passion for this because I really believe if you don't understand the message that Jesus was speaking about, maybe you could have missed Jesus altogether. If you don't understand the message that he was bringing, maybe we can't miss Jesus altogether. Mark 1:14 says that after John was put in prison, Jesus came to Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. Once again, he's always talking about the gospel of the kingdom, the gospel of the kingdom. Verse 15, and he is saying, and what is the gospel of the kingdom? Chapter 1, verse 15 sums it up. So if you forget everything that I told you, just don't forget Mark 1:15. Mark 1:15 sums it up. The gospel of the kingdom is four parts, and you see it in this verse. First part, the time is fulfilled. That's the first thing. The gospel of the kingdom is the time is fulfilled. Number two, the kingdom of God is here, is at hand. Number three, repent, metanoia, change your mind, renew your mind, put away the labels, put away the prejudice, come with fresh lenses to watch the kingdom. That's number three. And finally, number four, believe in the gospel. So basically, Jesus is saying the time is fulfilled. What does that mean? If something is to be fulfilled, it has to be previously promised. Jeremiah promised the Messiah. Isaiah promised the Messiah. David prophetically sang about a Messiah. The minor, the major prophets all pointed towards the Messiah. Jesus comes, remember, preaching in the synagogues. That was his pattern. And he walks in, and remember when he reads out of the book of Isaiah, he shuts the scrolls and says, today this is being fulfilled. He's basically saying, I am the fulfillment of everything you and your lineage have been studying, all you Pharisees. And of course, I mean, that ticked them off. Like, who are you to say you're the fulfillment of everything that we promised? Are you telling me that my granddaddy, my great-grandfather studied about the prophets, and you, a carpenter, you are the promise fulfilled of everything that I've spent my life studying? Jesus says, I am kingdom incarnate. I am Messiah. Wow. Bro, that was enough to tick anybody off. Does that make sense? Not only then, they'll say, all right, so if you're the king, where's your kingdom? He says, the kingdom is here. Number two. That's what he just said. The kingdom is at hand. And they're like, we don't see anything. Later on, the same Jesus would explain this to Pontius Pilate. My kingdom is not of this world. He's saying my kingdom is spiritual. It's another dimension. It's coming. It's above this physical dimension. Because in the physical, all they're seeing is the Roman Empire. We see Roman soldiers. We see the Romans oppressing the Jews. Where is your kingdom? We thought the Messiah would come as a military leader to overthrow Caesar. Where are you? He says, no, my kingdom is here. I am the Messiah, and I brought my kingdom. It's here. How come we don't see it? Because you got to repent. They're not happy with this. But if they did repent, and if they did get a fresh lens, and if they did actually renew their minds and understand that it was spiritual, then they would say, how do I take part of that? And number four of the message, or the fourth part of the message, is believe in the gospel. How do you take part of the kingdom of God? You just believe it. By faith you're saved. And so Jesus is bringing the kingdom message as he's teaching us in Mark 1:15. And so when you learn the kingdom message and you understand that, I understand that maybe one of our biggest mistakes is that we as Western Christians mix our destiny with our mission. Where is our destiny? I don't know about you, but I'm sure of my salvation, I'm going to heaven. Who can say you're going to heaven as well this morning? All right, so that's our destiny. But hey, that is not our mission. My mission is not to get saved. That's my destiny. I get saved and I'm going to go to heaven. All right, T, so now I'm saved. I'm 28. What do I do for the rest of my life? If you only preach the gospel of salvation or the gospel of grace, what we tell them is, come to church on Sunday, put your Christian butt on the pew, and just wait till he comes back. Wow. Oh, you know, I don't care that people are getting, killing each other out there, that as long as I'm saved, I'm going to go to heaven. I'll just not lock myself in this church, and I'm just in my gospel ghetto here in my evangelical bubble, and I'm going to go to heaven. Does that make sense? So when we mix our destiny, what's my destiny? My destiny is going to heaven, but what's my mission? It's bringing heaven on earth. That's my mission. So when we understand that, you don't understand that when you preach the gospel of salvation only. So when we celebrate, we need to celebrate when people get saved. The word tells us that there's a party in heaven when everybody, which with one soul is being saved. And that's biblical for you to celebrate. But you know what? I'm thinking, let's celebrate people getting saved, but also let's celebrate people discipling nations. Let's see the altar of salvation not as the end, but what if we saw this as a takeoff to a journey? Does that make sense? And so as I'm looking at this, I start realizing, that same strategy has always been and I see this especially in nations where we've seen amazing church growth. You know, Satan's strategy is not, hey, look at you here today. Whether you're a Christian or whether you believe Jesus Christ or not, the fact that you're inside a church on Sunday morning shows me you're on a spiritual quest. Shows me that you have, you know, a minimum of ethics and values that you're living by, and that you realize there's something beyond this earth, that there's something eternal beyond this earth. So for people like us, Satan is not going to come with a gun and say, go rob a bank. That is not how he takes you out of your focus. That's not how he wants you to make you backslide. He doesn't put a knife in your hand and says, go stab somebody out on the street. You're not going to do that. Look at you. You got a minimum of some values and ethics. Wouldn't you say so? Kinda. Just prophesy that over somebody next to you. You have values. But you know what I've found to be Satan's strategy is make sure the church doesn't preach the total gospel. Just preach part of the gospel. Make sure the church doesn't go for the best. Just go for the good. It's good enough for you to be a Christian and be a good citizen. Let me tell you, Jesus did not die on the cross for you to become a good citizen. You don't need to be a Christian to be a good citizen. I know friends of mine that are agnostics that are better citizens than Christians. I know friends of mine that are Muslims that are better citizens than Christians. They'll pay their tax there. I mean, all sorts of stuff. They follow the rules and they don't get tickets and stuff like that. You know, Jesus did not die on the cross for you to be saved and just be a good citizen while you are on a countdown clock until he comes back. There's got to be more than that. And when we just preach the gospel of the kingdom, that's all we get. Or the gospel of salvation, that's all we get. But when Jesus comes with the gospel of the kingdom, we're talking of Genesis 3, picking up from there and saying, Lord, why is it that you're bringing the second Adam? And when he brings in the second Adam, we pick up from where Adam left off as he's taken care of all the creation of God. And so us as the chosen people, there is something that we need to understand as stewards of what God placed on this earth for us to do, to multiply and bring kingdom into what we call earth. Does that make sense? So when I start understanding this, is that Jesus always publicly was speaking about the kingdom of God. He's talking about the gospel of the kingdom. But what are we doing as people? We're talking about the gospel of salvation. And I'm not against you publicly speaking about the gospel of salvation. I'm not against that. I'm in favor of that, actually. But the thing is, as long as you don't take it out of context of the kingdom. Because what the Western church is lacking today is a revelation of the gospel of the kingdom. I remember when this man of God that passed away, he was a pastor out in the Caribbean, deeply influenced me. His name is Miles Monroe. I don't know if you ever heard of this man. I remember when he was alive, he challenged me once. He says, T, I challenge you, read the Gospels and find me one time that Jesus spoke about being born again publicly. You read the Gospels and you make notes, he says. Make notes what he's speaking when he's speaking to the public. He's talking about the kingdom of God. And why is that we don't talk about the kingdom of God publicly? We're just talking about salvation publicly. John 3, open with me real quick. Verse 1 says, there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus. And Nicodemus, ruler of the Jews, came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher that comes from God, for no one can do these signs, say with me, signs, that you do unless God is with him. So what Nicodemus is doing is, you know, he's a Pharisee. So he's watching this Jesus do many things. There's a commotion around the person of Jesus, and he's watching him from afar. Jesus gets up, preaches publicly about the kingdom. In the synagogue, he's talking about this kingdom of God. He's teaching about this kingdom of God. Publicly, he's healing the sick. Publicly, he's casting out demons. He's doing all good. And suddenly, Nicodemus, a Pharisee, says, I'm not going to, you know, this intrigues me, but I'm not going to ask him publicly. He goes in private in the middle of the night. He knocks on Jesus' door. Jesus opens the door. Nicodemus comes in, and Nicodemus says, Jesus, I've been seeing the signs. You know, signs, if you can substitute that, what about if we say the facts? I've been seeing the facts. I've been seeing the fruit of what you've been doing out there. We know this is not normal. This has to come from God. Now, what did Jesus answer him on verse 3? Verse 3, he goes on to answer Nicodemus and says, "Most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus never asked him, "Can I be born again?" Nicodemus did not knock on his door in the middle of the night and say, "Hey, yo, I want to know about this kingdom of God stuff." All Nicodemus did was knock on his door and say, "I see signs. I see facts. I see your fruits. Something is different outside. I don't even know what to explain it, but I know there's something out there that I don't know. It's out of this world. How can I be part of that?" And Jesus says, "Oh, what I understand your heart is saying is you want to know the kingdom of God. For you to be part of the kingdom of God, you need to be born again." Does that make sense? I started understanding that the Lord is going to bring people to our churches. The Lord is going to bring people to us that do not have the Christianese lingo. They're not going to come. Don't expect your coworker to come to you and say, "Man, I just feel the glory around you, bro. What is this?" He's not supposed to talk like that. He's not of the kingdom yet. Does that make sense? So it's a quick story. Maybe a six months ago, we did it back home. We did this. We have an online ministry school, and we do every month of March. We give out free courses. March, April, and in the spring, we give out 4 classes for free. And when we usually do that, we get a lot of traffic on the internet. So we have to hire another company to actually put this up in our platform. And so we hired this secular company. They're the best at what they do. And so they're putting up our content up, and people are signing in. In a matter of 1 month, more than 90,000 people took our courses. And so they need a special server and everything for that. So as they're doing that, our director of operations, his name is Dennis. Dennis sends me a message, and he says, "You got to check out, you know, the people that we've contracted, that company we contracted. The owner just sent me a message. I'm going to forward his voicemail, his audio message to you." So he forwards this guy's audio message to me. Now, he owns the company that's doing this. He's not a Christian. And he says, "Dennis," on the audio, I'm listening to this thing, and he goes, "Dennis, I put everything up. The video's up and ready. You know, I put the plugins like you wanted. It's all set up. If you go into that email, you'll know the password to access that." He's just giving him everything. And he says at the end of his message, "Oh, by the way, I actually listened to the teaching, if that was okay." And he says, "What the fee? My God, man, that just blew my mind. I love it, bro. I love it. I praise God for that. For more of those audio messages. That is more spiritual than an evangelical saying, 'Praise the Lord.' Because it has more essence to it. I can't expect a worldly guy to be like, 'Oh, Jesus, shit, I'm a quarter, baba.' No. He needs to cuss. Because when his team is winning, he cusses. Does that make sense? Yes. I'm not saying he speaks profanity, but if he's in the world, that's what he's got. And Nicodemus had that vocabulary. Signs. Facts. It's out of this world. I don't understand. Jesus had the spiritual ears to translate his vocabulary and say, what you want is the kingdom. Let me show you the kingdom. You need to be born again. My question, and that's what I've been asking myself, how many Nicodemus have been knocking at my door? Wow. Saying, "Hey, T, your family, man, I see the signs. Hey, T, your ministry, I see signs. I see signs from Mount Zion Church. I see signs from Dunamis Movement. I see signs from the Hayashis. Man, what is that?" And I could say, "You know, what you're asking about is the kingdom. Do you want in? Oh, for sure. You need to be born again." Every time you just talk about blood, cross, salvation, born again, private setting, but something was the hook that dragged them in. It was the kingdom activity in society. Does that make sense? Now, check this out. If you open it with me to John 10, John 10, just leave that open. Maybe two, three weeks ago, I went to a city south of Brazil. It's not where I live. It's maybe, you know, 6 hours south of where I'm at. And I was with my second or third degree cousin. And he actually owns restaurants. And he was talking about a restaurant that he just recently opened, and it was a steakhouse. And he was telling me it was the best steakhouse in town. So I was thinking about it as he was sharing. You know, imagine you as a business guy here in LA, and you own restaurants. If you have the best steakhouse in LA, and you're trying to tell your friends, and you go to your friends and you say, hey, check this out, guys. I opened up a steakhouse. It's my new restaurant. It's the best steak in LA. And everybody's like, wow, tell me about it. And then you say, all right, so this is amazing. So the steakhouse is in downtown LA, and I built it in such a way that I put this huge door in the entrance of it. Okay? But let me tell you about the door. It's an amazing door. It's a huge door. Oh my gosh, it's a magnificent door. Oh, it's marvelous. The door, awesome. Awesome door made of wood, of cedars of Lebanon. I had it shipped from Lebanon. And boy, man, those, it's a thick, I mean, oh, the wood in the door, oh my gosh. The door, oh, also the handles, whoa. Golden handles. You can see the gold from afar on the other side of the street. Is that a good marketing strategy for your restaurant? But that's what we do when we talk about the kingdom. John 10 verse 9 says, I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved and will go in and out and find pasture. The thief does not come except to steal and to kill and to destroy. I have come that they may have life, and that they may have it more abundantly. Now, who is the door? It's Jesus. Now, I'll tell you, King Jesus is the first one to say, don't just talk about the door, go in. And don't just stay in the entryway, go in. Does that make sense? First mention of the church. Say with me, I am the church. First mention of the New Testament church, which is this, what we are. Matthew 16, come with me. Matthew 16, verse 15. People are asking, or I mean, people have opinions about Jesus. Jesus in verse 15 says, what about you? Who do you say I am? Simon Peter answered and says, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter or Petros, and on this rock I will build my church. What rock is he going to build the church upon? The truth that Peter just said, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. The truth, he is the Messiah, Son of the living God. That is the bedrock of the church. And so he says, I will build my church upon this rock. Now, let me ask you, who's speaking this? Jesus. Okay, so when he says, I will build my church, who does the church belong to? Who does the church belong to? Okay, so you belong to Jesus. Person next to you belongs to Jesus. We are the church. We belong to Jesus. Who's going to build the church? Jesus. So Jesus is saying, it's my church, I will build it. And then we may ask, so what do I do? And then he goes on and says, verse 19, I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Well, what does that mean? He's basically saying, listen, as you worry about expanding the kingdom, I will take care of my church and I will build my church. Does that make sense? Now, the phrase that he uses, upon this rock I will build my church, in the original text is ekklesia. Ekklesia in the original root word means the called out. And actually, ekklesia is a political term. Jesus does not say, upon this rock I will build my synagogue. He does not say, upon this rock I will build my temple. He says, I will build my ecclesia. Now, what was the ecclesia at the time? Ecclesia was a political agency sent by Caesar as a cultural police of Rome that would travel around all of the Roman Empire, making sure that people were living the Roman way. They were basically ambassadors of the Roman culture. Ecclesia were made of apostles. Apostolos, which were the leaders sent by Caesar, commissioned by Caesar, to make sure that people were eating like the Romans eat, they were talking like the Romans talked, they were dressing like the Romans dressed, and even if they had gone all the way out to India, you know, the glory of the Roman Empire was not that they would actually decimate those people, but that they would actually subjugate those people to live like they did in Rome. And to enforce that, Caesar had his ecclesia. So Jesus picks up a political term and says, now you are my ecclesia, and you will take my kingdom culture to the nations. Now he says, I give you the keys and the authorities. You do that. Don't worry about the church. I build the church. So what's the problem when we worry about the church and forget that we're supposed to expand the kingdom? You know, whenever you're talking more about your church than the kingdom of God, something's up. When you glorify your church brand over the kingdom of God, you actually play against the efficiency of the church. Does that make sense? So let's go back to the door, and I'll finish with this. He says, I am the door. If you come in, you will be saved. And he says on verse 10, John 10:10, the thief comes to steal, rob, and destroy. I came to give you life. And life abundantly. It's one thing for you to have life. It's another thing for you to have life in abundance. I don't know about you, but I'm not content just coming out of Egypt. I will only be content when I come out of Egypt and I enter the promised land. Some people are okay with, I got out of Egypt. Bro, there's so much more for you. Does that make sense? I don't just want to live saved. I want to live saved and all that I'm living, saved and called. And Jesus says, the thief comes to rob, destroy, and steal. I came to give you life and life abundantly. And I'll finish with this. Imagine, and I need your imagination now. Imagine the kingdom of God, a big, beautiful mansion. Can you imagine that? Big, beautiful mansion. It's got an amazing door. That door is Jesus. And you know you gotta come into the kingdom. You've seen the kingdom manifested by the church out there, and he says, I want part of it. They say, hey, if you want part of the kingdom, all you need to do is believe. What is believe? Is go through that door. So you go through that door. You go through Jesus, the door. John 10:9. Once you get through the door, you're inside the kingdom. And you come into this mansion. And I need you to imagine this. It's a beautiful mansion. It's got excellence, wisdom, and beauty all over. So many rooms, so many corridors. And right in the living room, you see the Trinity. And the Trinity comes up walking to you. And the Trinity says, welcome to the kingdom. And he says, this is amazing. And then you say, so I have life now? You have life. You're saved. You walk through the door. This is it? And he says, no, stretch out your hand. And you stretch out your hand, and he comes and gives you the keys of the kingdom. It's not the keys to the kingdom. You don't need no key to get into the kingdom. You just walk through the door. You get the keys once you're inside the kingdom. That's why he calls it the keys of the kingdom, not to the kingdom. And you get the, you know, the set of keys, and you say, so what do I do with this? And he says, the enemy comes to rob, steal, and destroy. I came to give you life and life abundantly. And the Trinity says, just start opening some doors. So you go to, you grab your set of keys, and you find a door. And you start looking at the keys, and you're trying to fit one in there. And above the door, it says, emotional health. And you open, and you step into the abundance of life with emotional health. Does that make sense? You get out and you say, hey, is there more? So there's a bunch of rooms here. Just use your kingdom keys. and you go to the next room and it says physical healing, and you unlock that and you step into the abundance of physical healing in the kingdom. Now, are you saved? You could have just been saved inside the living room without opening any keys. You're still saved. But all you're living is the gospel of salvation. Jesus came to bring you the gospel of the kingdom. As we use our keys, the church grows in its efficiency. Does that make sense? In Washington, D.C., there's a Brazilian embassy. When I step in there, I'm in Brazilian territory. If I go to Washington, D.C., and I step into the Brazilian embassy, I'm in Brazilian territory. But I will not see the Christ of Rio de Janeiro in that embassy. I will not see the Amazon River in that embassy. I will not see the streets of São Paulo in that embassy. Why not? Aren't you in Brazilian territory? I am. But the embassy does not contain the fullness of my country. The church is the embassy. But it does not contain the fullness of the kingdom. It's kingdom territory. The kingdom is so big the church cannot contain it. But the problem is when we think we need to start opening embassies instead of expanding kingdom. And what the Lord is calling us to do, if you want an embassy that's efficient, it's not based of how many embassies we put in the country. It's how much can that embassy impact with its nation's original impact in that new territory. And that's what the Lord is looking at us right now. Just stand where you are. I want to pray with you. I believe the Lord has raised this place as an embassy. This is Kingdom Embassy, Expression 58. Do you believe it?
Yes.
And the Lord is saying, no, as you go Monday through Friday, using your keys, loosening, binding, as you expand the kingdom influence, the Lord is building this. And the efficiency of E58 depends on how much you're expanding kingdom until the kingdoms of this world become the kingdom of our God. Father, you are our King. We recognize you as our King. We are your people. Your word is our constitution. You've given us keys to unlock different levels of authority in the kingdom. We want to use that Monday through Friday as we do the Great Commission. And Father, we're believing that this territory, Southern California, needs to be totally taken over by the kingdom until the kingdoms of this world become the kingdoms of our God. Just repeat after me, Lord God, give me your grace to carry out the kingdom interests, the kingdom impact, and the kingdom influence in our society until the kingdoms of this world becomes the kingdom of our God. In Jesus' name, amen. Bless you.